Evening is, as ever, a privilege and a pleasure. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk for about 50 minutes, show you some pictures, tell you a bit about those creatures, a bit about their lives, and perhaps sometimes about the need to conserve them. And then we're going to have a break, and then, I don't know how long the break will be, but whatever. And then a shorter second half with questions at the end. I'm going to break it down. So the first half is going to be a bit about conservation, ecology, behaviour, basically all animal, bird-based, all that sort of stuff. Second half, a bit about photography, no technical detail, don't run for the door, won't be ISO numbers and shutter speeds or anything like that. And I'm going to finish up by showing you a presentation, which I've shown about six times now. Initially, I was just going to show it the once, but I've relaxed a little bit. It was something which I produced that was very personal to me, and I didn't really feel like giving it away too much. But I'm going to give it away again tonight, so we're going to finish off with that. And that will involve some awful music from the 80s, so you've got that to look forward to. Not awful, but interesting. Anyway, I'm going to start off by talking about British birds of prey. It seems apt to do that at this time, given the Hen Harrier campaign that Tim's already mentioned. But here is a kestrel, male kestrel, and in 1974 I lost my heart to one of these birds. I was already passionately into wildlife, and I had been since I was crawling around in the garden, torturing tadpoles in jam jars and ladybirds in matchboxes. But I got into birds when I was about 12. Up until that point I needed animals that were tangible. I needed to be able to put them into tanks and matchboxes and jam jars. But then I got a pair of binoculars and realised that I could still interact with them, but I didn't need to touch them and torture them. So I started studying kestrels, and I would cycle from my house on the edge of Southampton over 70 square kilometres, and I would find all the kestrels' nests, and I would climb up to them, I was a fit young man, and count all of their eggs, and then I would count how many of those eggs hatched, and then my biology master from my monstrous comprehensive would come out and we would ring them. And he encouraged me to write this whole thing up as a study. However, 2 years into it, I put my hands up and say that I did something completely illegal, and that was I took a kestrel from a nest. Because I'd applied for a Home Office licence, as was required at that time, but working class oiks from Middenbury weren't granted such things. So I decided to, you know, do what I always do, which is plough belligerently on, and do my own thing, and I took the bird from the nest, and of course, I wouldn't encourage any illegal activity. I wouldn't encourage people to collect birds' eggs, which I did, and Bill Oddie did, and David Attenborough did. And I certainly wouldn't encourage people to remove raptors from nests. Times have moved on, the age is different, there's no need now. If you want a kestrel, you can get a captive bred one very easily and inexpensively. But, nevertheless, that was an incredibly formative period of my life. The 6 months that I had that bird before I lost it, well, they're the reason I'm standing here this evening. I learned so much from it. I learned a lot about myself. I learned a lot about you as well, other human beings. And I developed a very deep passion for birds of prey. Of course, I followed the fortunes of kestrels ever since. At that time, in 1974, they were the commonest raptor in the UK by some considerable margin. They are no longer. The buzzard has overtaken them. Actually, there have been a couple of kestrel surveys. To give you a statistical reference of how rapidly they're declining is quite difficult. I'll have to speak to the BTO about that in the morning. But basically, they've declined by 20% between 2005 and 2008, and 36% between 2008 and 2009. So you do the maths, it's all a bit confusing. But there are species that's in critical decline. The problem is, we're not entirely sure why. It's probably because there's not a single factor involved. One thing is for sure, of course, loss of habitat and intensification of agriculture are certainly playing their part. This is a bird which has a great range of items in its diet. We'll eat everything from earthworms, invertebrates, reptiles, even amphibians very occasionally. Certainly birds and, of course, mammals. But the thing that it's optimally evolved to do is to hunt small mammals, principally short-tailed field voles. Now, short-tailed field voles require rough grassland. Rough grassland is that which has a dense leaf litter layer. So I know that woodland has leaf litter, but so does grassland. If you don't rake it, and if you don't fertilise it, and if you don't graze it or cut it every year. And that rough grassland is essential for these voles because they live in that leaf litter. They live there so that they can't be spotted by kestrels. Kestrels, however, can use the ultraviolet part of the spectrum to see. They can see an ultraviolet, and they can see the rodent's urine. And I've seen quite a lot of rodent urine over my time as well, but not in ultraviolet. But nevertheless, they spot the rodent's urine, and that's how one of the ways that they are able to catch them. And of course, rough grassland is, you know, as the as many would consider, unproductive land. Therefore, there's not much of it. The reason why we saw so many kestrels hovering alongside our motorways in the 60s, 70s and 80s was that that was untouched rough grassland. It wasn't ploughed, it wasn't sprayed, and it wasn't grazed. So there were voles there, and that's why the kestrels gravitated to that area. But, as I say, they're in precipitous decline. I think there are probably other factors afoot as well. Some suggest it might be the increase in the number of buzzards, that there's competition for the two species, because certainly their prey overlap. Buzzards will eat small mammals as much as kestrels. But I think that the rate of decline, and the fact that it's occurring all over Europe, many parts of Europe where the number of buzzards didn't collapse as it did in the UK, then there might be something else. What I worry about are neonicotinoid pesticides. Hands up, who's heard of neonicotinoid pesticides? Excellent. These could be the new DDT. They've been in use since the 1990s. They are systemic insecticide. So they are in, when they're applied, they are taken into every part of the plant that they are protecting. The roots, the stem, the leaves, the flower, the pollen, and its seeds. And we know now from recent studies published in the last couple of months that they are showing up in bird species. Scandinavian work has shown this, and they're having a negative impact on birds. UK research is showing that they're having a negative impact on invertebrates, earthworms, and soil bacteria. Last year, our government voted against a two-year moratorium of their use in Europe. Thankfully, they were overvoted in Europe, and there is currently a voluntary moratorium not to use neonicotinoids in Europe whilst research is done. I think trying to ban these things, as we eventually managed to ban DDT in the UK, is going to prove tough. There are huge multinational companies, Bayer, Monsanto, who are powerful, and obviously they're pumping this stuff out. I was very saddened to see a farmer on the news recently rebutting the idea that they could be responsible for impacting negatively upon wildlife and saying that if we didn't use them, he'd have to spray a lot more other toxic chemicals into the environment. Good thinking that, mate. What about organic, was my thought as I was watching the 10 o'clock news. So looking after kestrels in the future could be difficult because they might just be an indicator of something truly insidious in our environment. Whatever, we need to work very rapidly to understand the causes of this decline, otherwise we're going to lose this delightful little raptor. I should add that they are declining over the rest of Europe too, but nowhere near at the same rate as they are in the UK. I can also add that in the last 25 years, we've had a 40% decline in large beetle species, prey of the kestrel, and a 40% decline in large moth species in the southern part of England. Again, those could be attributed to neonicotinoids. We just need the evidence to start the argument. And at the moment, scientists are avidly trying to gather that evidence. The barn owl is a species that It's a nocturnal kestrel, as you know. It feeds on similar sort of prey, only it does it when the kestrels are roosting at night. So it's out there after small mammal prey, and again, short-tailed field voles play a significant part in many of our barn owl's diets. They declined in the last century by 90% up until about the 1980s, but they were an iconic bird. They were one of the early conservation icons, and a tremendous effort was put into their conservation, and we came up with some useful means of doing it. The first thing we did was identify that there was a shortage of nest sites, because the name barn owl was always appropriate when there were old-fashioned barns for them to nest in. But of course, contemporary agricultural architecture doesn't allow for nooks and crannies, and all of those old barns were either pulled down or they were restored into houses, and all of a sudden we had a shortage of nest sites. So people started putting up barn owl boxes, initial just tea chests actually, and farmers did this and conservationists. I can tell you at this point in time, we have in excess of 25,000 barn owl boxes that have been erected specifically for that purpose in the UK. 25,000 boxes for barn owls. What an amazing initiative. That's fantastic, and it's worked. Because 50% of the 3,000 to 5,000 pairs, it varies depending on how good a vole year it is, 50% of those 3,000 to 5,000 pairs of UK barn owls are nesting in those boxes. So that is a simple conservation success. Of course, we don't use tea chests anymore, because I haven't seen a chili chest for years. I don't think they exist. But we've come up with up-to-date Barn Owl penthouse boxes, which you can buy flat-packed off the internet and then spend ages building in your garage. Whilst swearing, but not quite so much as you would be swearing if you'd bought something flat-packed from IKEA, of course. Because when you open that, none of the fitting screws are inside, and you've got to go back to IKEA again. Which is like another journey to hell. Anyway, so simple, practical conservation measures are working. Nevertheless, barn owls are still decreasing by 0.3% a year. What's going on? Well, we've discovered a lot more in the interim period, not just about lack of nest sites, but of course, similar lack of habitat providing for their prey as appropriated to the kestrel, but also because unlike kestrels, they get run over rather a lot. Kestrels, you see, are hovering alongside the road, and then they drop down, and then they drop down onto the verge. The barn owl's hunting technique, as every single one of you knows, very different. They quarter from side to side. So as they're drifting along those road verges, looking for the voles, they drift out into the line of traffic where they are killed by white vans. Yeah. Research has shown it's not cars. Some get killed by cars, but most get swept over the top. Vans are just a little bit too high and they hit the top of the van. Doesn't really matter who's killing them, the fact is they're dying. And what we know now is that if barn owls are trying to nest within a couple of kilometres of a major road, that's A road or larger, their young fail to colonise new areas because they're killed on the roads. But if you get a road atlas out tonight on your way back to wherever you're going and you look at a map of the UK with all of its A roads and larger, you'll see there's not much habitat left for barn owls. So at the moment, the impact of traffic on this species is preventing it from recolonising areas where it's disappeared, even if there's good habitat, or even maintaining populations in areas where there's good habitat if those birds vanish for another reason. So traffic is having an impact. Again, something that we need to study and rectify if we want to stabilise and even increase our barn owl population. Charismatic bird, though, attracts a lot of attention. Heart-shaped face, looks a bit human, allegedly. Forward-facing eyes and a beak that looks like a nose. Well, not like my nose, I hope, but nevertheless. A bird which suffered during that last pesticide crisis very severely was the sparrowhawk. Dieldrin, Aldrin, DDT, all of these post-war chemicals, which were untested and hugely damaging, built up in the bodies of these birds, top of the food chain, ate smaller birds, gradually accumulated in their bodies. The impact was that it either killed the birds outright, or it caused problems such as eggshell thinning. So the female sparrowhawks and other raptors laid eggs that were too thin to survive the incubation process. Despite the fact that they're terribly gentle when they're incubating, they fold up their talons, and they crawl into the nest on their knuckles, the eggs were still fractured, they didn't hatch, the number of sparrowhawks plummeted. They survived on the western side of the UK, where there was less arable farming. Of course, we got rid of DDT and Dieldrin. We largely stopped shooting sparrowhawks, or gamekeepers stopped shooting sparrowhawks, as they weren't responsible for the crimes they'd formerly been accused of. And the population has bounced back. And we've now got sparrowhawks in the east of England, in the north of England, and many of you have them in your gardens. And they'll be swooping through, murdering...